Grocery stores are not that much.
I'm going to sit on the other side to balance it out. Hey Ben, how's everything? Excellent. Got clean bill of health. So I'm on maintenance now. Every 3 months, yeah. The 25th of September. They said everything was out of me, everything is clean. So they said they'll do the monitoring, but they do every 3 months, they do a CAT scan. So they said they'll do that in the first year. Then they'll move to 6 months, and then to a year. So they're very happy, and even when they did their CAT scan, they said that little thing that was on my lungs, they're monitoring it. They said it's not a problem, I think it's too small to worry about. So I said, all right. I said, please, I don't want to live with lung cancer, I just got out of the thing. So he says, no, he says, we believe it's scar tissue that's in there, and it's just going to be a problem. So it becomes a problem, then we'll have to take it. I feel good, Joe. I mean, I still have, my stomach still gets rumbly at times. I get some good depth. Most of the times I'm good, you know. It's just like, I just, it'll hit me like I'll eat something, and then all of a sudden it was knocks the crown out of me. Then I have to take all my stomach medicine. No, I'm not. They're very good with it. They said, the only time this time, Joe, is I took off the weight, now I'm going to start putting it back on. So I want to make sure that I got to get so I'm not tired, so I get back on the treadmill and just do my walk. And this is the perfect weather for it, because I love this weather. You know? I really should get going back to the gym. I have a thing for trampoline. And I love the stuff, I love the pool, so I should really, you know, like get up early, go out to the 1 hour with little neck. Yeah, and then the department has been good, so I got to find out when they want me to go back to work, so that would be the next thing. So, Gene, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Good.
You look great.
Thank you. I feel good, thank you. She's been very good. I would like another month because the chemo's washing out of me still. So I really would like to get another month, and I think that's when my system will kick back a little better with my digestive system. Because now I get up in the morning and it's like I have to give myself like a good half hour, 45 minutes just to get the body acclimated. So we're getting up and we're going to have breakfast. You know? I do good. I now get up and I have a cup of coffee, and then all of a sudden I'm running to the bathroom. Then I'll eat something, then I'm running to the bathroom now. So it's kind of tough on that. And then I get crappy sleep, so you know, I'll go to bed for 4 hours. And I wake up and then I do more sleep. Yeah. And it's hard because I get very tired, like at 7 o'clock, and I'm trying to stay awake. So I can really go to bed like 11 and get a good hour's sleep. But everything else really is very good. Just, yeah. Yes, thank you. Well, I think it's all the prayers and stuff everybody gave. Really, I did very well. Yeah, it's the, that kept me going. Just was very nice, everything worked out well.
These are two different items.
Yeah. Got it. I heard you. Thank you.
Yeah.
Oh, no. Oh, I thought I was going to.
They look.
I mean, this is three times, five days. Any question?
They're different, yeah.
Test this.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, nice. Well, it's a good stepping stone if you want to get out or something later on, you know, it's. I want to go to Marshall's for investigation. If he wants to do that. If he doesn't, he'll still have a great time. It's a great, you know, I mean, he might. You're not going into the fires anymore, you're going after them. So it's nice to be able to find out who's causing it.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome. So let me introduce the new director of community boards, Vicki Morales. Very exciting time here at Queensboro Hall. And we are here today joined by city planning, the proposed mandatory inclusionary housing and zoning for quality and affordability zoning text. I did that all one way. Zoning text amendments were referred out for 60-day review on September 21st by city planning. In addition to the presentations at each of the 14 community boards tonight, the Department of City Planning will present the proposal to the borough board. Borough Board vote on these text amendments is scheduled for the next meeting on November 16, 2015. By that time, all of the community boards will have acted or heard the presentation. Presumably, the Borough Board will be prepared to vote. Do we know when the drop dead date is for the Borough Board?
Drop dead is November 30th, but we will take recommendations up until early December.
Just in case we're wrong.
Yeah.
We now welcome from the city planning, housing, economic, and infrastructure planning division, Laura Smith, who will give the ZQA presentation, and Eric Kober, who will address the MIH presentation. I need to apologize, I'm speaking at my son's school at 6:30, so if this runs a little longer than that, we will be able to keep the staff coming by then as well. And we welcome city planning and look forward to your presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you. Many of you will recall that last year the mayor published his Housing New York plan, and mayor's Housing New York plan is intended to produce or preserve 200,000 units of affordable housing over the next decade and build on the previous administration's plans, but provide yet more affordable housing units as we try to address the city's ongoing housing crisis. So what are the sort of reasons why we're in this situation, why we seem always to be in this situation? Well, the city's population continues to grow, and this is of course true in Queens as well. Since 2010, the city's population has grown by about 230,000 people, and about 600,000 more people are expected by 2040. In Queens, boroughs at an all-time population high of a little less than 2.3 million, and it's projected to grow to more than 2.4 million by 2040. Not only is the overall population growing, but the population as a whole is becoming older, and the senior population, the people over 65, expected to grow by 400,000 people by about 90,000 in Queens as well. There's a gap between rents and incomes, and this is because housing is forever in scarce supply and rents increase faster than incomes. This results in high rent burden. Many people pay a very large percentage of their incomes in rent. There's a limited supply of affordable housing in the city, and a lack of resources outside of the city's own resources that can be allocated to affordable housing. So Housing New York is a multifaceted plan, and it has many aspects to it. It is, first of all, addressing the need to create more affordable housing, and proposes to create 80,000 more affordable housing units over 10 years. It's 8,000 units a year. It proposed to reform the 421A tax exemption program to promote more affordability in new housing that gets tax abatements. And the state legislature enacted something that was very close to the mayor's original proposal in June. And to address some of the zoning issues that are impediments to affordable housing, and we'll talk about in this presentation. There are also components that are intended to preserve existing affordable housing and prevent displacement of existing tenants. Those are in the plan. They're not things we're going to talk about tonight, but they're very important components of the mayor's plan. And in addition, there are plans to rezone neighborhoods and invest in those neighborhoods as they are rezoned. And again, we're not going to talk about that tonight, but you'll be hearing about proposals in Queens over the coming months as well. So first we're going to talk about mandatory inclusionary housing. Mandatory inclusionary housing is a text amendment, a proposed zoning text amendment, to create a new program. The program isn't applicable until an area is designated. The first area that's designated as a mandatory inclusionary housing area is in Brooklyn. It's East New York. It is also going through public review. And again, additional mandatory inclusionary housing areas will be proposed over the coming months. But right now, we're only talking about creating the program. So what are the goals? The goals are to promote vibrant and diverse neighborhoods and ensure that as areas grow, that affordable housing is a component of those areas. The city currently has a voluntary inclusionary housing program, and that has been successful in some areas, particularly where it's been coordinated with 421A as a tax abatement program, has not produced affordable housing in every area where it applies. The goal of mandatory inclusionary housing is to provide assurances to communities that as they grow, affordable housing will be provided, again, for a range of low and moderate income New Yorkers. The mandatory inclusionary housing as opposed to voluntary inclusionary housing raises some very significant legal issues that any program has to meet. Those legal issues are addressed by applying the program consistently rather than on a modifying it every time it's applied, and to ensure that it is happening in light of considerations of economic feasibility. Inclusionary housing has to work in order to provide affordable housing in the context of growing neighborhoods. The city contracted with BA Urban Economics, an experienced affordable housing consultant, to produce a study to ensure that this proposal is consistent with economic feasibility. And what they found is that there's a trade-off between the percentage of affordable housing and reaching lower income levels. This kind of makes sense. The more affordable housing you require, the harder it is to reach lower income levels and still be economically feasible. In the strongest housing markets in the city, there is ability to support a requirement for affordable housing in the range of 20 to 30%, depending on the range of incomes that are being targeted. Middle markets do not support this kind of affordability without direct subsidy unless moderate incomes are targeted. And in the weakest markets, direct subsidy is required to target all incomes for affordable housing. And a requirement as high as 50%, which has been proposed by some affordable housing groups, is not financially feasible in all contexts. So what are we proposing? We're proposing what is the most rigorous mandatory inclusionary housing program of any major U.S. city. And this will be applied in rezonings where a significant amount of new housing is proposed. And there will be two basic options which can be applied separately or in combination. One is that 25% of new housing units have to be affordable at a rate, at an average of 60, what's called 60% AMI, which as you can see for a family of three is about $46,000 a year. The second option is that 30% of housing has to be affordable at an average of 80%, which as you can see for a family of three is about $62,000 a year. And there is available a third option, which can only be made available with at least one of the other two options. And that is called the workforce option, which is a moderate income housing option, in which 30% has to be affordable at an average of 120% AMI, which as you can see is about $93,000 a year. And this is considered to be an option which would be useful, particularly in moderate income areas, where this level of affordability is characteristic of much of the housing. Other key requirements of the proposal, the required affordable housing units would be permanently affordable. There would not be a term, as there is for some city affordable housing programs. And